opportunities abroad for the Philippines. Be entrepreneurs for the Philippines. In this globally interconnected world, success, I believe, will go to the country and the culture that is able to establish worldwide networks that create competitive advantage. If the University of the Philippines is to take the lead in S&T-based industry development, and I think it is an important task for you, it is important to attend to graduate education and research in science and technology. Yes, of course, that's foundational. But it is equally important that individuals and groups emerge who will bring the different pieces together. Technology innovators, business, legal and regulatory framework, Filipinos and friends abroad who will create opportunities and markets for us. I think we have to start thinking of Filipinos abroad as not lost to us, but as opportunities for us. So far, the first part of what I wanted to share this afternoon. Second part, I wanted to talk about the greatest challenge we still face in the country, which is the poverty gap. So the first part of my presentation shared some of my views on the challenges of the UP as a national university in attaining levels of excellence in international competitiveness in science and technology. The next question is, excellence and international competitiveness for what and for whom? What does it do for UP's stakeholders? This is certainly good and wonderful for UP's alumni, faculty, students. It enhances the value of their UP degrees, their UP affiliation. It opens doors for them. But UP prides itself on being the national university and your students being a scholar ng bayan. So bayan is a stakeholder. And so we have to ask, what does this do for the bayan? And I'd like to tell you one picture of the bayan. And we have a video clip of a public elementary school, Lupang Pangako, where we have been working. It comes actually from one of these programs of Mike Enriquez, Investigador. It's very powerful and very striking, and I wanted to show it to you, what it looked like in 2003, but also we hope what it looks like today.
Sa Lupang Pangako Elementary School sa Payatas, Quezon City, siksikan ang mga bata. Sa sobrang dami ng estudyante, nagkaroon ng tatlong shift ng klase. Apat na oras lamang kada araw ang pasok nila. Bukod dito, isang dating covered court ang hinati sa siyam na silid arala. Tagagtak ang pawis ng mga bata. Para magkaroon ng konting hangin, binubuksan ang gate ng covered court. Pero mahirap talunin ang ingay ng siyam na klase. Ang ibang bata abala sa pakikipag-usap sa mga kaibigan sa labas. Hirap din magkarinigan ang guro at mga estudyante. Siyam na klase. Nang iba'y may 85 estudyante, bawat isa.
What is the sum for? 4 and 5.
At dahil sa dikit-dikit sila, kung ano-anong kalokohan ang nangyayari.
Uy, wag kayong magkopyahan.
Posible rin magkahawahan ng mga batang may sakit. Sa eskwelahan din ito, in ang may payong. Umaraw man. Uumulan, swak ang payok. Abay, double purpose. Basa na nga ang lamesa ni ma'am, bumabaha pa. Pero hindi rito natatapos ang problema nila.
Wala kami talagang canteen. Wala kaming clinic room. Wala kaming library room. Faculty room. Wala kami lahat niyan.
Pagamat may bago raw silang gusali na bigay ng lokal na pamalaan, marami pa rin kulang. Ultimo nga prinsipal sa daanan ng nag-oopisina. At para sa mga guro, isang maliit na lamesa ang nagsisilbing faculty room.
What I want to share with you is that it's possible to change. But the first picture is that that was the scene, and that's still the scene in quite a few public elementary and high schools. They have three shifts a day, 6 to 10, 10 to 2, 2 to 6. So Amartya Sen, in an article in the New York Times a couple of years ago, says, to build a country, build a schoolhouse. And he continues, I am aware, he says, that when I argue that basic education for all can transform the miserable world in which we live, I sound a little like a Victorian gentlewoman delivering her favorite recipe for progress. As it happens, however, extensive empirical studies have demonstrated the critical role of basic education in economic and social development in Europe and North America, as well as in Asia, Africa, and Latin America. What I do want to say is that this dream from Amartya Sen is possible. The principal that you saw, Mr. Ben Kaling, is an amazing man. He transformed that school. We worked with him, but he transformed that school. You saw the rankings that were there. In 2003, they were number 94 of 96 in Quezon City. Average national achievement test of the 40%. This year, they were number 13. And their average was about 83. And I do want to show you what it looks like today. With the leadership of the principal and the community, and the responsiveness of the mayor. So as the story of Lupang Pangako illustrates, the challenge of poverty is tremendous among us, and it focused particularly on education. We started working with them, but success is possible. Ateneo started working with first four, then eight of the poorest grade schools in Quezon City several years ago. We chose Payatas because we felt if we could succeed there, we could probably succeed in most places. When we started dump site, all have improved. A year ago, we agreed with Mayor Belmonte to work with all their schools. We'd like to really highlight also the role of local governments. Those school buildings were built by the local government. They're all built by the Quezon City. Our experience is that it will take the effort of all sectors of society to rise to this challenge. The Department of Education is essential. Local governments are essential. The principal and the community, above all, are essential. This Mr. Kaling has been in three schools in Payatas. He always chooses the worst school, and he has transformed all of them. An amazing man. But universities can make a difference. And here lies a deep problem. As the title of my presentation indicates, it will not be easy for us to bring together our pursuit of academic competitiveness and the task of improving public education. This was brought home to me in a very stark way in a recent symposium I attended. In March of this year, I was invited to present a paper at the centennial, the 100th anniversary, of the International Commission on Mathematical Instruction in Rome. I was asked to speak on mathematics education in developing countries. I spoke in particular on our Philippine experience, and a major part of my report was on the experience of the third elementary education project. Dr. Malu de Ronila worked very much on it, and the work we do in Payatas, and that of Sinergia Foundation in the autonomous region of Muslim Mindanao. I reported on this also in the meeting last year. During the discussion and the open forum, however, the questions were all about how our work could contribute to establishing mathematics education as a scientific discipline and how it could lead to research and international publications. In other words, my colleagues were primarily interested in how this promoted our particular discipline of mathematics education. I realized that there was a serious disconnect between my own concerns and those of my scientific colleagues. We were on parallel tracks. And as the symposium went on, I realized that the concerns of mathematics education as a scientific discipline and the concerns of improving children's mathematics performance on a large scale or on a national scale were on divergent paths, maybe parallel paths anyway. So when I asked in my title whether the path towards international competitiveness and overcoming poverty can converge, it is because from my own experience, they can actually diverge. The path towards international competitiveness leads us to outstanding scientists, international recognition, gives us great prestige, but it can leave the task of overcoming poverty untouched. On the other hand, if one focuses on the task of overcoming poverty, one finds that one must engage in many things, working with local governments, organizing people, raising funds. These are not disciplinary endeavors, and so do not lend themselves to research projects with clear methodologies whose results can be published internationally in internationally recognized journals. This divide is not easy to bridge. The difficulty is not due to any lack of goodwill and desire on our part. They are rooted in the cultures of universities and academic disciplines and in the institutional organization of the modern university. There are two ways we can use to understand this difficulty. The first is from Howard Gardner in his latest book, Five Minds for the Future. He describes the first two minds as, first, the analytical mind, and second, the synthetic mind. The analytical mind breaks down problems into different components, masters one or the other of these components, and creates new knowledge about them. This is the mind we focus on the most in universities, the mind that does groundbreaking research and publishes respected scholarship. The synthetic mind, on the other hand, brings together knowledge from disparate disciplines and from expertise beyond the academe to solve a particular problem or to build something new. It is the mind of an entrepreneur like Ted Turner, who built CNN, of Bill Gates, who built Microsoft, of many leaders in the world. While we need the research and deeper knowledge coming from analytical minds,